What's up, and welcome to another episode of Evie's Review. On this episode, I'm gonna do a Commodore 64 tune-up. So originally I was gonna do a repair video. One of my subscribers sent me a Commodore 64 that had a black screen. This is the notorious problem. To quote him, he said, either it's a really simple thing or a ridiculously hard thing. Well, it turned out it was a really simple thing. Here is this machine that I'm going to try and repair. It's still in the bubble wrap. All right, so this is a Commodore 64C. I have freed it from the bubble wrap. It's looking a little bit musty on top, so the first thing I'm gonna do is give it a little cleaning. I'm seeing inside there's some warping of the bottom plate and there's some furry stuff, so it definitely could use some cleaning. I got my trusty wintergreen scented alcohol. I don't know if you're really supposed to use this green stuff for non-human purposes, but I haven't had any trouble with it so far. So I just give it a good spray down all over. Now, I ordered some of these nice nylon brushes. These are really great because they're scratch-free, but they also really get deep into things. They've got a lot of bristles. It's like a toothbrush for giants. So I'm gonna scrape out some of this crap in here. Now you'll also want to absorb some of the dirt on a cloth or something. And you'll notice the whole front gets a few shades lighter just with the alcohol. So I even go across the keys with this thing. These old keyboards, the letters are pretty solid and the nylon doesn't damage them. Now, one thing that's already obvious to me about this machine, it's definitely one of the earlier 64Cs, because you'll notice that the keys have the PETSky on the front. The later models put it on the top. So even though it is a 64C, I'm suspecting it might even be a B3 revision, one of the really early 64Cs, because you don't usually see those PETSky on the front. So you see the nylon brush will really get a lot of that caked dirt to get loose, but then you really need to wipe it down with a rag. And don't go light on the alcohol. You have to kind of keep spraying it because it'll evaporate. Now make sure to also get the sides and the back because there's a lot of grime on this thing. I actually have a nickname for this brown stuff. I call it retro poo. But the great thing is that alcohol does cut through it pretty easily. On the keys, you kind of have to go diagonally in all directions to get in between them. If it was really nasty, we could even take the keyboard out and clean the keys individually, but I don't like to be too invasive if there's not something I really have to get in there. What's clear about this machine is there's a lot of dust built up in there, which means probably two things. One, that whoever used this back in the day used it a lot in a typical home environment. But the other thing it tells me is that it probably hasn't been opened up anytime recently, because a lot of that dust would disperse. So that's actually a good sign, because when you're repairing stuff, you really want it to be as least tinkered with as possible. Because if the machine is not working and it was already worked on by someone in the past, chances are they might have made it worse than it was to begin with. A lot of times you'll get these machines and whatever it is that's wrong with them, someone was trying to work at it, but they just gave up. But this one looks like it just kind of died on its own, which really makes repairs a lot simpler. And lastly, the back. The one place where you really don't want to get any alcohol is around this label, because this label will just fall right off. Often this number can reveal quite a bit of information about when the machine was made and where. You can see here it says, made in USA. That's actually pretty rare. Usually the machines are, even the USA sold machines are made somewhere else. Definitely get these little feet here. Got a lot of grime on them. Alright, so that's about all the cleaning I'm going to do for now. So now I'm going to open the machine up and see what's inside. This particular model has these star screws. It's always nice if you have a screwdriver that's magnetically charged. If you have a screwdriver that's not magnetically charged, you can actually magnetize it with one of these. So you put it in the thing that says magnetize, and you just wiggle it all around as much as you can. Actually, that seemed to demagnetize it. So what I did to fix it, if I just take the bit and I just kind of pass it through here, I don't know if this is the best way to do this, but this actually worked better than just wiggling the base. So I got it unscrewed. I'm gonna open it up now. Now, this is the part you have to be the most gentle with. There are these little tabs in the back that can break really easily. So what I figured out you wanna do is, you wanna pull the top of the case towards you so that the hinges stay resting in the slots, because if you try to pull them straight up, you'll break them. Alright, this side of the case was kind of hard to open, and I was worried because I didn't want to break it. But I noticed this side, there's a little tab right there. So that's where you have to apply the force upwards. So that's what I did over here, and it freed itself. Okay, now remember what I said for pulling the case towards you? That might just be for the bread bins. This one, you can see before you even open it, you can see where the tabs are, and you kind of want to just push it back a little bit so that the tabs slide out. And you want to do this all very, very gently, because too much force and you will break it permanently. Especially if these have been in storage for a long time, they can get kind of caked together. And so they're really sticky. So I think the best way to do it on this machine is just to kind of wiggle it until it comes loose. Never apply a lot of force. All right, so I managed to get it free without breaking it. That's good. And you'll notice the power light, the power LED is connected by a wire here, which is apparently underneath the keyboard. So I'm gonna wanna remove the keyboard, and I'll need a Phillips for that. That's gonna need some magnetism as well. Put these screws in a safe place. Now the keyboard slides right out. I'm gonna have to loosen the connector over here. And make sure you don't strain the wires. So what I'm doing is I'm holding the black plastic part with one hand and then pulling very gently on the wires with the other hand. And you kind of want to rock it every which direction and use as little force as possible. So I'm kind of wiggling it free a little bit from either side. Right, and it's free now. Like I said, this machine must have been in storage for a long time. All that dust kind of builds up grease or something, or that retro poo I was talking about, and just everything's just really tight and stuck. So I'm not gonna bother cleaning all this stuff right away. Just wanna open this all up and see what's going on in here. So for testing, you really don't need the keyboard at all. And then this is the power LED, so I can take that off, and that way the top will come free. The direction on these is always tricky for me, because sometimes if you put it in the wrong way, you won't get the LED lit up. This one happens to line up pretty sensibly. All right, so that goes to the side. I also don't need the lid for testing it. Now there is definitely a lot of, I don't even know, I'm guessing this is pet hair mixed with years and years and years of dust. I can really just wipe down some of this dust here. Ah, so I already see it's a 425, which is actually really surprising because I've seen 466 Commodore 64Cs. I don't think I've ever seen a 425 Commodore 64C. That's a really, really early Commodore 64C. One of the very first production runs of these things. So next, I'm gonna unscrew this shielding here. And it's also the star screws. So once all the screws are loose, I can just lift it out and then I'll make sure to grab the screws before they disappear. Now these screws look identical to the case screws, but I'll still keep them separate, why not? I've got this handy box here to keep things nice and separate. And what's nice about this one is the compartments don't come off, which can be really annoying. What's nice about keeping these separate is then it's really clear what's what. These are the case, keyboard, and then the shielding. And what's also nice is you can close it so they won't go flying. I've got to say, this is some of the most gross looking shielding I've ever seen. I mean, there's just a tremendous amount of dust in here. I'd be surprised if this thing worked at all. It's really, really caked on these little tabs here. And that's really bad for the heat sinking, because you see that all of this dielectric grease, what that is, it's non-conductive silicone thermal paste with little tiny particles of metal in it. So it conducts thermally, but not electrically. And you see that pretty much it's all dried up. So you need fresh goop on there to give adequate heat flow. And that could certainly contribute to chip overheating and burning up. But I think typically the problem with these machines is just that they weren't designed to last for 40 years. And rumor has it the MOS branded chips have a much lower reliability rate than some other brands. And you can see a little bit of rusting or some kind of corrosion. I tend to not really worry about that. I mean, if you were a real perfectionist, you could use some hardcore chemicals on that, but I just don't like using anything super toxic. There's almost no rust on the underside. Now, here's what's really interesting. 1984, assembly 425. So really, this was a board that could have easily been put into a bread bin. I mean, it's practically a bread bin machine that just happens to be in a Commodore 64C case. You'll notice the chips are all the 6000 series, so they're not the later generation 8000 series chips. Although, what's interesting here is there's an 8701, which assists the VIC chip. It basically consolidates all the mess of parts that used to be on the older revisions into one chip. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and spray down this board. What's interesting about this revision is that they took away this whole shielding that used to be around this piece here. And I guess the reason they could do that was because they added this big piece of shielding that just goes over the whole thing. I actually feel like I just want to wipe this down with a cloth because these traces and these pins are so delicate that I really think I could damage it with this. So I'm just being extra careful here. But definitely go liberally with the alcohol. And try not to spread this paste around too much. It gets this icky white film everywhere. So I'm gonna use this just on the edge of the chip here. There's a lot of gunk in there. Yeah, I don't want that gunk to get mixed with the solder if I have to reflow or rewire anything here. This is a funny little part right here. I can just put that along with the screw for it right there. A common problem with these machines, just because people tend to plug and unplug the joystick so many times, is you very often have to reflow the solder on the control ports here. I'm kind of sick of wiping this down, so I'm just gonna blow off the rest of the dust and debris. It's always great to visually inspect and just notice what catches your eye. Even if it might be nothing, you'd be surprised how many times some little thing catches your eye, you don't know why, and it ends up being an issue. I'm definitely noticing some corrosion around these diodes here and here. Ah, so even though the motherboard's 84, if you look at this sticker here, its production runs 8 through 13 in 1986. Now there's just a couple more screws here, and then I'm going to be able to get to the underside of the board. Alright, with all the screws out, I can kind of just pry it out of here. And again, just use kind of a gentle wiggle. Don't use a lot of force because you don't want to break anything. So there, it seems like the power switch has a tendency to catch right on here, so you really just gotta wiggle. Alright, so the back is just a nice metal shielding. If I can't fix it just by lifting up the VIC and the SID out of their sockets, what I'm gonna have to do is desolder these tabs here to remove the shielding off the bottom. But really the first step is to run the diagnostic. Let me plug it in and see what's going on with it. All right, here is the Commodore that I had outside. I've brought it indoors. And I've got a BackBit cartridge preloaded with the dead test. And I've got a Commodore 64 power supply hooked up to a saver device, and I've got an 8-pin video out. I have a cheap converter box that's doing the conversion for the screen here. It's not ideal, it doesn't have the best picture, but it's functional. So I want to find out what condition this machine is in. So I'm going to plug in the power and turn it on and see what happens. I'm not gonna see anything if I don't have the video plugged in. Oh, and it works. Huh. Okay, well that's a good sign. Working Commodore is good. Just for shits and giggles, I'm gonna put the dead test in and see what I get. Dead test looks good. So I'm guessing there might just have been some corrosion, and just doing that simple clean down fixed whatever corrosion was causing a short or whatever. All right, I'm running the diagnostic. Of course, I don't have a harness, so a number of the tests are gonna fail. So these bad tests are expected to be, oh, there's the sound. Okay, so now the real fun is putting the harness on here to see. On the surface, everything's looking good, but I just want to make sure. I want to give it a full test. So here's a harness I built myself. It's not uber fashionable, but it's functional. I coated it with electrical tape because this was before I got my 3D printer. So I'm gonna plug it in and see what happens. All right, so I've got everything plugged in now. Just make sure all the connections are super secure. Plug the power back in. Let's give it a shot. Okay, so it's testing just fine. So in a way, this video ended up being about cleaning and me getting my equipment straight, which is important because, you know, you could have the best techniques. I mean, you could have the most knowledge about a computer's parts, but if you have bad tools, it's gonna destroy everything. All right, so I bent that pin back into shape. And I think it's gonna be okay. Obviously, I wanna eventually make a nice 3D case for this. I've just been lazy. Electrical tape is not good construction material. All right, so the machine's been on for a minute. I'm gonna touch all the chips with my finger, just on the very top, just to see if they feel hot to the touch. That's fine. Fine. Yeah, so nothing feels particularly warm. I would just put it to the fact that because it's a Revision B board, it's electrically much more stable than the earlier boards. So I'm actually impressed. This thing's in great shape. Let me just pry open this guy here to see what's going on under there. Wow, that is just so clean looking. You see this weird goop? I think that's pretty normal. But this whole device looks pretty solid. Oh, there's a little bit of dust. So because there was nothing wrong with the machine, I felt bad that he sent me this machine, paid for shipping, and it's like, okay, now what? So I gave the machine a tune-up. I recapped it, and I refreshed the silicone grease. And I inspected the whole computer, and it's in great shape. Check it out. To work on it, the first thing I have to do is to desolder these tabs here. And to do that, I'm going to need to change the bit on this soldering iron. Okay, so here's the soldering iron with the new bit. Alright, looks like that's all heated up. So the trick here is I just gotta get this flathead soldering iron right underneath these little tabs here. And it should just melt away. Got this nice fan, this smoke absorber here, really helps with all that solder so you don't breathe it in. It is a bit noisy though. This has got to be the most pesky spot on the board because it's right between these two connectors, so you got to be really careful not to melt these connectors off. So in fact, that tab just kind of snapped off. And last but not least, we got this one on the RF adapter here. Another thing to watch out for is don't melt this piece here. If you have a lot of trouble with the solder, you could always reflow it or put some flux on there. Okay, so I'm seeing it's mostly a pristine board, with the exception that there's some gunk underneath here. But I think that might just be some resin from the initial soldering, which is actually just fine. It looks like whoever installed the RF modulator just left a lot of residue on there. So one cool thing about this revision, I've never seen this pretty navy blue insert. Usually it's just a ugly plain brown cardboard, but this is a pretty navy blue. How about that? So the first thing I'm going to want to do is just give a good reflow on the solder for these control ports here. I'm going to change this tip back to the fine point to do my soldering work here. Alright, so now I've got my original fine point tip back on here. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to reflow the solder on these control ports. What always happens is because these things often get a lot of wiggle, the solder will come loose here. So if I reflow them all, they'll connect much better and they won't have that problem. Alright, that looks pretty good. I think that will give it many years of life to go on. Yeah, like I said, this board is in pristine condition, so I really don't want to touch a thing, but I am going to recap it. So I see these three caps over here. Notice that it's plus over here and minus over here. I think what I'll do is I'll just take out one leg of each of these and put the new capacitors in with one leg as well, that way I don't mismatch anything. So for this part of the job, I'm going to use my trusty Hakko desoldering gun. This makes it really easy to remove all that solder off of there. So often, even after you desolder, things can kind of stick there, so I give it a little pull, not on the wire, but on the base, while I've got something hot on the other side, and that'll usually loosen it free pretty easily. So you see I've got all these free now, so I'm going to lift them up and make room for the new capacitors. And it looks like I have some nice holes ready for them. So I'll match up not only the microfarads, and you'll notice the voltage is higher than the original capacitors for a lot of these, and that's absolutely fine. There's no issue with having a higher voltage, that just means it's capable of holding a higher voltage, but it doesn't have to. So the 470 goes over here, and I want to line up those arrows. So you'll see that it's pointing. It says minus is going on this side, and this is the minus side over here. And then on the other side, I'll just twist it over just so it stays. So then the next one's a 2200, minus sides over here. And then the next one is 1,000. And the minus side is over here. So a little bit of solder left over on that one hole. Sometimes if you have some really stubborn solder that won't come off, it's nice to use this desoldering wick. So in this case, I think I'm actually gonna have to reflow a little of that solder just so it comes loose. Alright, I think I finally got all the solder out of there. Okay, and once again, make sure all those minuses are pointing that direction. Because you'll see the plus sign is over on this side. So now that those new capacitors are in there, I'm gonna tie them down with some electrical tape. And now it's time to fully remove the old capacitors. And I'll be using the desoldering iron again for that. It's good to give it a little wiggle, and it looks like that one capacitor is kind of more stubborn than the others as far as staying stuck on there. And you can even try to loosen the solder up on this side here. There we go. So now I'll put these other legs back in here. Alright, so now that I've got these capacitors in the right positions, it's time to put some solder back in. So I gave it a little extra solder on the top just to close up those holes. Normally I wouldn't go on the top, but these are really easy access. All right, so this board has been recapped. I suppose I could reseat these chips, but I'd rather just kind of leave them because I don't want to upset the balance here if there's nothing wrong with it. All right, so pretty simple job here of just put new capacitors there, reflowed the solder on the control ports. I think that's basically all there is to it. Because the board looks great. It's absolutely pristine. Oh, before I forget, make sure to cut the legs off these capacitors so they don't short anything here. Another good thing to do, since these contacts look a little messy at the edges, is give them a good spray down with electrical contact cleaner spray. And I'm also going to spray this expansion port here. Right, so now that I've recapped this machine, I'm gonna go ahead and reattach the shielding. One thing that's really critical, make sure this cardboard is in here. If this cardboard is not in here, the machine will short out and you'll blow this fuse here. Alright, and the very last thing I wanted to do on this board is put some of this silicone heatsink compound onto these little tabs here. You don't need a lot because you don't want it to get too messy. Alright, so then this piece is going to go back on here. Now this is why it's nice that I saved these things in all these little compartments. Alright, now the motherboard is totally intact with the case. I'll put the keyboard back here. Make sure to get the front groove of this keyboard for the C64C under these little tabs here. Before I plug in the keyboard, I want to plug in the power LED. And then finally these little keyboard screws here. Alright, and this is the last part. I really want to be careful not to break these tabs here. So I'll put this right under there. Okay, you see it got all snapped in there gently, of course. Finally, these last three screws, and that's it. So I'm going to go back inside and I'm going to test those capacitors just to see how bad they were. I gotta say, this is one of the coolest revisions of the Commodore 64 because it's new enough where it's really solid electrically, but it's still old enough where they didn't dumb it down too much. It's a board from 1984, which is literally the same time as the video games crash and when Commodore's CEO was moving over to Atari. So it was an exciting time in the computer industry for sure. So here I am testing to see what the state of these old capacitors was. Of course, I'm going to get a more accurate reading because they're out of circuit. So the old 2200 microfarad, it's measuring 2200. That's so, it was actually fine, but can't hurt to replace it. The 1000, it's measuring only 813, so it was definitely good to replace that one. The 470 is coming up as 445, so yeah, worthy replacement. So all in all, it wasn't a bad idea to replace those capacitors. And you never know, they can get blown at some point. So just for comparison, I'm going to show you what values I get for these brand new capacitors. So the 2200 is actually about 2250. So it can't hurt to have a little boost there. The 1000 is actually measuring at 1140. And the 470 is actually 505, so these are definitely overperforming, which I don't think is a bad thing for them to be slightly over capacity, better than under capacity. So there you have it, a freshly tuned up Commodore 64. Thanks to Ben for sending me this machine, and he said he's going to do a review of BackBit. That's originally why he sent me the machine, so I hope to see that soon. Anyway, if you like this video, make sure to hit subscribe so you can be informed of upcoming videos. And thanks for watching Evie's Review!